I find that game design is a lot like listening to black people. It's pretty easy once you give it a try. Today we're going to mix things up a bit. I'm launching a new series about the early stages of making my own video game. It's a great way to have some in-depth discussion about specific game design ideas, and today we'll be breaking down character creation and the initial inspiration for my story. As the series progresses, I plan on focusing in on very specific mechanics and game design ideas. But first, have you guys heard of Raid Shadow Legends? That's right, your boy made it. I know a fair chunk of y'all like turn-based RPGs, and Raid is just that, a highly strategic RPG with over 25 million downloads. So you know it's doing something right. It has an epic story with challenging combat scenarios, as well as an active PvP community. There's a massive cast of 300 potential champions to recruit, all with unique sets of abilities, stats, and party roles. Heroes have different levels of synergy with each other, and just because you found a team that works for now, doesn't mean you can keep using the same strategy over and over. You really do have to mix it up. Galak's my personal favorite so far, and he seems pretty popular too, and it's easy to see why. He can attack all enemies at once, he can heal his allies, he can boost his speed, and he has deep-seated psychological issues. What's not to love? Oh, and there's like 1,000 videos on the game uploaded to YouTube every month, so if you're ever feeling a little intimidated by all this math, there's plenty of people making guides who are willing and ready to help you. It's a super helpful community. And it has some really impressive graphics for something that's available on mobile. Make sure you act fast, because if you use my special link in the description to try the game, you'll get an extra 100,000 silver and a free epic champion, Jotun. God, he looks cool. You can download the game and get more information with the link in the description. Thanks to Raid Shadow Legends for sponsoring this video. Games. They represent an infinite variety of ways to have fun, but also an infinite variety of worlds, perspectives, satires, stories, challenges, strategies, head-scratchers, and tear-jerkers. Moments that celebrate our humanity while criticizing the depth of our cruelty. I've spent the last 8 years on this godforsaken hell site celebrating the connections that game designers have made with me, for better or for worse. Reflecting on the trials and tribulations of heroes and villains, seeing good people try to do the right thing but hurt others in the process, and then go on to learn the proper lesson. Not to stop fighting injustice, but to be smart in how you do it. I've seen violent, hateful, and brainwashed people change and question their authority, question their own family members, their own leaders and mentors. And I've seen the power, history, and human empathy that goes into this sort of media. I've seen games teach me about real life and help me contextualize things that my young mind couldn't process on its own. Games can be a gateway to emotional learning, healing, and growth. In some cases, it can lead to open connection and community for someone who really needs it. And I guess that's why I like making games. Would you believe I've been making games longer than I've been reviewing them? Well, I've been making shitty drawings of 2D platformer levels with stick figures since I was like 4, but to get more specific, I started learning how to code and make my own games around the tail end of 2005. I met an awesome gay girl in middle school, and we taught each other how to code in each other's basements. This is a more common backstory for game developers than you may think, with those exact details. Anyway, you might be wondering what program I use to learn how to make games, and what kind of program I'm gonna be using today. Well, RPG Maker. But yeah, it's a really good engine. People have made all kinds of classic, memorable games with the RPG Maker engines over the years. Lisa the Painful is one of the most unique, funny, and emotionally engaging games I've ever experienced, period. And it has some genuinely impressive battle mechanics, a balanced sense of challenge, and some really tough decision-making. Yume-Nikki, the original Lisa, and Ib all represent a diverse collection of narrative games with puzzle-solving and open-ended storytelling, not to mention some good old-fashioned horror. Off is a remarkable surrealist RPG with a grim, uncomfortable atmosphere I've never seen another game emulate. I love it. And I'm not just saying that because I'm friends with the person who translated it. Shout out to Quinn. Gaia's Melody is cute as fuck and has some really charming character dynamics. RFL has a remaster and a new engine that looks great and you should go support it, but the original version is also goddamn beautiful. It looks like a forgotten gem of the 16-bit era, but it was all made by a single talented dev with little in the way of outside help. Most of the games I just described were made by a single developer. So when I think about the RPG Maker community, I don't really think about this, I think about this, and this. I could go on. People don't really hate RPG Maker, they hate the default RPG Maker aesthetic. And the reason why they hate that is because everyone who makes their first game obviously uses default assets. And then a small minority of crazy people think the first test file they make is worth putting on Steam for $10. You can make a great game using default assets in various programs like this. It's not like they're all ugly or anything, but most of the games I'm referring to are low effort in every other regard as well. I get that this line of engines has a reputation, but that reputation is based on the actions of a few lazy devs or kids who don't understand what they're doing when they put something for sale on Steam because their parents aren't monitoring their internet usage. I'm honestly proud to be a small part of this unique and passionately supportive dev community. As I said before, me and one of my best friends taught each other how to code with RPG Maker XP in the mid-2000s and throughout high school. A few years ago, I got back into RPG Maker with MV in 2016, and I have a gigantic project that I am not going to be showing in this video, but I have put well over 2,000 hours into that one project alone. In fact, if you're even remotely interested in game development and you're not making an action game, this is a really good way to start getting your hands dirty with some real dev work without any prior coding knowledge. It's a low-cost way to see if game design is something you can enjoy and commit to. Even if it just turns out to be a hobby for you, it's probably going to be a fulfilling one. Now, the tools at your disposal matter a lot less than what you choose to do with them, but the tools are still important. You can think of a dev platform as your starting point, a base for the broth of your delicious video game. This metaphor is getting away from me. I want to make a top-down RPG with first-person combat. It's gonna have some pretty classic sensibilities, and I have a budget of 30 cents and a ketchup packet, so RPG Maker it is! Every dev starts at a different place. We all get inspired by different things. When I make a game, I'm mostly inspired by people, their stories, their decisions, and how they grow from their mistakes, or let their regrets define them. The characters are everything to me. I try to use my characters as a way to get into the player's head and get them to really feel the role of the person they play as. And if we're going to tell an interesting story, we should try to tell it from an interesting perspective. I have a few loose concepts I've been wanting to work on for a while, so let's build our main character. When I first make a character, their vague appearance and basic personality just kind of bursts forth from my gray matter like a brain xenomorph, and I tweak it from there. For this game, I'd really like the designs to reflect their class roles and combat, their personality, and their motivations. If you want to write good characters, you have to get to know them first. You have to start writing for them, fleshing out their feelings, philosophy, how educated they are, where they come from. You have to start putting them in different situations, and then writing how they react. Characters can develop organically as you work on them. That's why it's so helpful to just start asking those questions and putting them in those scenarios. How do they feel about thievery? How do they feel about visiting different cultures on their quest? Do they get excited about it? Are they indifferent? Or are they more close-minded to foreign ways of life? How do they cope with hardship? If they had to pick only one type of skittle to eat for the rest of their life, would they pick grape like some kind of bitch? This kind of detail is important. It's how you take a basic, boring swordswoman and make a depressed swordswoman. That's much more interesting. I want there to be a reason my characters dress, talk, or present themselves in a certain way. Generally speaking, people have reasons for what they do and how they act. They might not be logical reasons, but they still have reasons. If someone asks how this character lost her eye, I should have an answer. Did she lose her eye to someone she trusted? Was it an accident? Was it a monster that outmatched her? Yeah, I like where this is going. Youthful, wide-eyed idealists have their place, but I think I'd rather do something a little different. And done. Meet Chandra. She's a former paladin, and she has seen some shit. I talked earlier about how a lead with a unique perspective can lead to a more unique story. And within the context of her own universe, Chandra has had a pretty unique life. and as I develop her backstory, I can use that as an opportunity to develop the backstory of the world itself. Because after all, in order to make a character's place in the world, you need to make a world. Chandra is a 37-year-old warrior who has fought monsters and people alike for 20 years. She was raised in the beautiful golden sands of South Zaret, where the twin moons rise over the ancient palace. She was a member of the Holy Blades, an ancient order of knights. Chandra dedicated herself to the betterment of her people, protecting them from monsters, bandits, and invaders. She's always fought with a two-handed longsword, and studied the martial traditions of the Zareti knights. She can use this weapon in various ways, inspired by the real-life techniques of medieval and Renaissance-era soldiers. That's where she gets her moveset from. She used healing magic to mend her allies in the heat of battle, but was chiefly known for her prowess in melee combat. Her reputation was the stuff of legend, and she was known to selflessly defend the weak under any circumstance. Chandra was known by a different name then. Lashawn, the name her mother gave her, the name she lost when she was banished from the kingdom she served for 2 decades. When her commander ordered her to kill an innocent person, Chandra refused and resisted. When the situation escalated, she cut down one of her fellow knights. Right on the spot, she was banished, with only the equipment that she had on her person at the time. I will keep the details of that situation under lock and key for now, because I kind of just want to make this game now. I got really inspired. Like, I actually don't want to spoil this. Like, I do want to make this eventually. When? No idea, but someday. Someday. Hold me to that. Don't hold me to that. Please don't hold me to that. Jesus Christ, don't hold me to that. I'd go on, but I'm already running out of stuff to show. 10 days, remember? I think you get the point. I just wanted to show how exciting it can be to start a new dev project, explain my inspirations, thought process, and how to build up a character, how to get started and really get into building your world. I would like to continue this subject, get into battle balancing and design and a bunch of other stuff, such as using character strategy and stats to reflect their personality and reinforce character relationships. This video took way less time for me to make because rambling about game design process is pretty much second nature to me. The video also has less dynamic editing, and it's a bit shorter than my other reviews, so I was able to get it out pretty quick. The patrons who got to see this video early have given me really positive feedback so far, despite these compromises. So if you enjoy this format, please let me know. This is a project I think I'll have a lot of fun with. And before we get deep into this series, I just want to establish some things before I get bombarded with questions about this game and this project. First of all, yes, all the graphics you see are placeholders. They're modified default graphics from the engine that I'm using for the sake of planning out the game's content. Basically, I need visuals on the screen in order to figure out what the mood, setting, and gameplay is. Eventually, I think I want a more traditional pixel art style with a dark, moody color scheme and sort of a 16-bit vibe. And as a general rule of thumb, this is incredibly early development and everything is obviously subject to change. And I'm not going to be revealing every solitary detail of the game because, like I said, eventually this is something I'd like to make available to purchase with a free demo available. I might kickstart it down the line and hire an artist and get some general funding to live off of since that's really the only thing I need help with, but that is far in the future. The job I actually get paid for is making videos, so don't be surprised if this game, or whichever project I decide to prioritize, takes forever to come out. I have limited spare time. Just wanted to preemptively answer those questions. Yes, I do want this to be an actual game at some point, and I want it to be a damn good one. So wish me luck, and I hope you look forward to it. Also, thanks as always for watching. If you enjoyed what you see, consider supporting my show like these wonderful people. You can find a link to my Patreon and all the rewards on offer in the link below. You can also follow my social media to stay up to date on all my new videos. I also plan on streaming more frequently in the near future on Twitch. My schedule has been the planet is basically destabilized at this point. I think y'all understand if some YouTubers' schedules are a little volatile. But yeah, in any case, I hope y'all stay safe, stay determined, and keep up the fight for a more equal and just world. but also take some time to rest. Take care.